Edward Curtis undertook and eventually completed the greatest photographic odyssey in American history, arguably in world history. And his goal was to document a people who were just at the cusp of what he thought was vanishing. It ended up consuming him, taking all of 30 years and amounting to more than 40,000 photographs. His masterwork is called The North American Indian. 227 sets were produced in all. They're worth a fortune now, though when he died, he had lost everything. Curtis himself had no more than a sixth grade education. What he knew of Indians, he said later, was from this picture he saw when he was a little kid, still living in the Midwest. And he saw this engraving of Indians during what was called the Sioux Uprising, who were hanged. It was the largest mass execution in American history, and it stayed with him. He spent much of his early years basically living a subsistence life. And he moves from this homestead shack. He mortgages it for $150. He takes up as a portrait photographer and photo engraver in Seattle and very quickly became one of the premier portrait photographers on the West Coast. Seattle is the biggest city in the world named for a Native American, but they've also made it illegal in this city for an Indian to live within the city limits, except for Angeline. She's the daughter of Chief Seattle. And Curtis convinces her to come up the hill into his studio, and he takes her picture. And it's a huge success. People have never seen an Indian portrayed quite like this. The typical attitude toward Indians at the start of the 20th century was that, you know, the wars were over, but everyone thought they were disappearing. They took a census count and found that there were only 235,000 Native Americans in all of the continent. About a year after he took Angeline's picture, Curtis is up on Mount Rainier, and he has another encounter that completely changes his life. He bumps into and ultimately rescues two of the most famous people in the United States. One of them is a guy named Bird Grinnell, who's the founder of the National Audubon Society and also quite an expert in American Indians, particularly Plains Indians. A friendship strikes up. Grinnell starts to mentor Curtis, and he invites him to come with him in the summer of 1900 to witness one of these vanishing rituals, the Sundance on the high plains of Montana. Over the course of the summer, Curtis gets to know these people, the Blackfeet Nation, the Pagan Nation, people who are buffalo hunters. An idea starts to take root. He tells Grinnell, I want to try to shoot all intact Native American tribes. I want to make them live forever. In 1903, Chief Joseph of the Nez Perce, perhaps one of the most famous Native people known all over Europe as well as the United States, is invited from his tiny little reservation where he's living as essentially a prisoner of war to come to Seattle and go to a football game. And Curtis takes two pictures of him that weekend. One is with Joseph with his headdress, and one is without. And these pictures become perhaps his most famous single portraits. By then, Curtis spent a few years himself with the remaining Nez Perce, and he understands that these people have suffered perhaps more injustice than any other American Indian tribe. They never waged war against the government. They had so many of their treaties broken. Less than a year after Curtis took that picture, Joseph died, and the reservation doctor said at the time that he died of a broken heart. Curtis starts out seeing Indians simply as a commodity. He can make money off them because there will be so few of them, and his pictures are so stunning. But over the course of time, as he starts to get to know these people as real human beings, as he starts to see how much of their culture is being erased, as he sees American policy, which is making it a felony for these people to practice the religion of their choice, he becomes less and less of a detached observer and more of an outraged advocate. And he's going to places that are incredibly hard to get to because Indians have been moved to the edges. He goes to the bottom of the Grand Canyon. He goes to the far, rough shore of Washington State where the Macaw live. He goes to the high mesas of New Mexico where he finds the Acoma living as they've always lived there. He has to go by horseback. He has to hike. And he's doing it at a frenzied pace because he's afraid that if he doesn't hurry to take these pictures, to record these songs, to record these rituals, it will all be gone. And in many cases, he finds he gets there, he is too late. pursuing this obsession, which is taking more and more of his time, is just diminishing whatever resources he has. He's literally out of money, has to rob from his studio to keep going, goes in to see the richest man in America, J.P. Morgan, who was also an art collector. And he asked Morgan to finance this great undertaking. Morgan refuses him. Curtis doesn't budge. He pulls out one more picture from his portfolio, and the picture is Mosa. And Morgan loves the picture. Mosa is the picture that wins him over. So he agrees to finance Curtis to the tune of $75,000, which in 1906 was a hell of a lot of money. And he spends a lot of time with his initial money from Morgan in the plains. And the interesting thing about this is that probably nothing did more to hasten the demise of the native people than the railroads. And Morgan's first big killing financially was to consolidate the railroads. So the volumes start to come out. Remember, Curtis does 20 volumes. By volume 3 and 4 and 5, Curtis is being hailed as a master. You've got this undereducated lone person from Seattle who's making book history. No one's ever seen native people who quite look like this before. And more than that, he's documenting their lives. These are stories of myths and diet and creation and habits. And someone later says it's the greatest single anthropological undertaking by any one man. And all of this is whittling away at Curtis the man. All of Morgan's money is not enough. Curtis is still behind. He can't keep up his payroll. And worse than that, he's losing his marriage. He's losing his family. Curtis has a bitter divorce in 1919. He suffers from, I guess what we would call it, manic depression today. He has no money to complete the project. He moves to California, and he takes up hack work. It had to kill him, this person who knew more about Indians than any Anglo in the United States, to be shooting the fantasy version of Indians in Hollywood. But he never gave up on the project. And so in the mid-1920s, he's lost all his staff, all his translators and technicians. And with his daughter, Florence, he finds in the California wilds, the redwood country, the coastal country, some people living along the rivers there. That allowed him to finish the volume on the California natives. And with his daughter, he then does complete the North American Indian by going to the Arctic. And he shoots pictures of happy Indians. People are smiling, families. He sees people who are untouched by the government, untouched by the Christian missionaries, and it greatly moves him. And with that work in the Arctic, he finally completes the North American Indian. But at the time he completes it, he doesn't own it. He's so deep into the House of Morgan that he has to give up his copyright. So in 1930, at the start of the Great Depression, Curtis hands over all rights to his work to the House of J.P. Morgan. Morgan ends up selling most of Curtis's masterpieces and more than 50 of the 227 sets to a Boston bookseller for $1,000. And Curtis himself is forgotten. He gets a 77-word obituary from the New York Times, and this great book achievement, The North American Indian, is not even mentioned. But he knew he had done something lasting. He had seen these natives as people, which most of his fellow countrymen had not done and wouldn't do for at least 100 years.